elucidation to make something that is hard to understand clear or easy to understand. We're talking about biblical things, those things in the Bible that seem tough. We're going to break it down, show you the real what's going on with those. Biblical elucidation.
Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40. The question that is being posed to Jesus by the lawyer in an attempt to entrap Jesus is, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Meaning, which of all the commandments is the most important law given by Moses? This question was to challenge Jesus' Jewishness, an attempt to turn the people away from Jesus and discredit him. It was claimed by the Pharisees that Jesus was against the law of Moses. Thus, they believed that Jesus would say a commandment that wasn't given in the law of Moses. By doing this, Jesus would be saying that he himself supersedes Moses, that he is greater than Moses, whom the Pharisees recognized as the greatest of prophets. And there arose not a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10. This question, what is the greatest, most important commandment, is both insightful and intriguing. On one hand, this question is supposed to entrap Jesus, causing him to incriminate himself with his answer, disqualifying himself as a Jew. This is the Jewish way of asking Jesus in code, are you Jewish? But on the other hand, it allows today's believers to glimpse into the minds of the first century Hebrew, revealing that the laws had levels and degrees of importance. What is most intriguing is when we realize that Jesus did not rebuke this idea. Jesus did not say, important, which is most important. There are no levels or degrees to the commandments. Rather, Jesus answers the question. And shockingly, he doesn't answer giving one of the Ten Commandments. Instead, he reveals that the first, most important commandment is, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And then he continues with the next, the second, and equally important of the commandments. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, making it evident that Jesus clearly supports the idea of greater and lesser laws. Further support of Jesus' answer can be found in the next chapter in Matthew 23, verse 23, where he speaks of the Pharisees having omitted the weightier, heavier matters of the law. This gives clarity to and stands as a perfect example of Jesus' position on whether or not there are greater or lesser laws. Jesus said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. Jesus quotes Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, which is the second verse of the most essential prayer in Judaism called Shema. It is so highly esteemed that it is recited by every Jew at least twice a day. It is also placed on their doorposts and bound to their foreheads and forearms when in prayer. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. At first glance, it seems that Jesus just simply recited the Deuteronomy 6:5 portion of Shema. But if we closely examine Jesus' words, he did not. For some reason, he did not choose to recite it verbatim. Jesus substitutes the word might with mind. But why? What is the impact of Jesus' seemingly insignificant and often overlooked word substitution, choosing to say mind instead of might? The word might, as given in Deuteronomy 6:5, is the Hebrew word mi'od, meaning deep feelings, while mind in Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, is the Greek word dianoia, which means deep thought, Strikingly, Jesus presents the contrast of deep thought versus deep feelings. The substitution of mind for might is a correction to a common mistake made by many believers, both past and present. Most of us worship God with deep feelings, but Jesus is telling us no. My Father requires more than just your displays of emotion, but commands you to worship Him with deep thought. He requires you to have intellect when worshiping Him, having purpose, being intentional, and coming to God with intelligence. This correction is made even more evident when we closely examine Jesus' words in John chapter 4, verses 23 and 24. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship Him. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. We must ask and discover what it means for true worshipers to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Does this mean that when we worship God in spirit, that we must go into a deep spiritual trance? Although many have understood this passage to mean so, the answer is no. The word spirit, Greek pneuma, means a current of air, a blast of breath, or a breeze of wind. But it also has three distinctions when being applied to beings. A human spirit is a rational, living soul. A superhuman spirit is angelic or demonic. The divine spirit is God or the Holy Ghost. With these distinctions in mind, the human spirit is a rational, living soul. Therefore, the human must worship God rationally, meaning having reason or understanding. Thus emphasizes the idea that Jesus highlights by replacing might with mind. Jesus is telling us that we must worship God having reason and understanding of God the Father. Without intellect, it is impossible to listen intentively, to adhere to, and submit to God's will, His teachings, or His guidance. It is impossible to submit to God based upon deep feelings. This is a mind changer. A mind changer that helps give clarity to the words given by Isaiah, saying God spoke these words, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Isaiah 1:18. Jesus says we must worship God in spirit, having reason, understanding, but also in truth. Truth in this sense means having nothing concealed, nothing hidden from God, exposing all of you to God. Thus, we must worship God, our Father, based not upon just deep feelings, but deep thought as well, and completely uncovered. Our sin nature is to cover ourselves before a perfect, sinless God. We can find that when sin entered the world, Adam and Eve's response to this sin was to cover themselves with fig leaves in order to hide themselves from God. Before sin entered the world, they came to God exposed. Matthew 22:39. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Jesus here quotes a portion of Leviticus 19:18. Thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord. Remember that this question was asked by those who claimed to accept the authority of the law, yet they refused to obey the laws and to live those laws out in their own lives. We must also remember that this response is Jesus' answer to a question that was supposed to entrap him. So what deeper thought was Jesus conveying through this extraordinary answer? Culturally, and unsurprisingly, the Jews were greatly afraid of idolatry. We can see this as expressed in the Shema. Hear, O Israel, that the Lord your God is one. Little known to today's believers, to the Jew, Jesus' claim to be the Son of God was seen as him claiming to be God. They found this to be blasphemous. Jesus, knowing this, responds by saying the most important of the law commands us to love God, but the second most important of the laws commands us to love our neighbor. Again, shockingly, Jesus does not say agape God, but philios, your neighbor. He intentionally puts emphasis on agape love. We are commanded by Jesus to give God and our neighbor both the same love, agape. These two commandments of loving God and loving neighbor are given with a level of equal importance. None of the other commandments are greater than these two. On these two commandments hang the law and the prophets, which to the Hebrew is the Tanakh, their entire Bible. Everything from Genesis to Malachi hangs on these two commands. But not just simply loving God and neighbor, but the meticulous details given for how we are to love God. The command to love neighbor is like the command to love God. Attention to detail is required when we study and read our Bibles. Jesus declares that the second is like the first. The first gives the details of not only commanding to love God, but also how to love God. To love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. This is to say that the second command is to also love thy neighbor with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, like the first. This is made clear and unmistakable by the Apostle John in 1 John chapter 4, verses 20 and 21. If any man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God, whom he hath not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God, love his brother also. So likewise, to answer the question, Jesus is saying to the Herodians, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the scribes that it is impossible for them to love God because they don't love him. Again, this idea is made clear in the writings of the Apostle John, stating that Jesus said, if God were your father, you would love me. John 8:42. Jesus brilliantly has foiled the entangling plot. Instead of being entrapped by those who intended to entrap him, Jesus has confounded them. Are you not commanded by the same laws that you seek to use to entrap me? Does it not say to love your neighbor? Am I not your neighbor, brother, and your fellow Jew? Does it not say thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people? But thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself? I am the Lord. Many of today's believers must take the time to carefully reread and study this passage, seriously reconsidering our views of Jesus' words. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Thank you for listening. Did you know that you can automatically receive biblical elucidation directly on your device weekly by subscribing on iTunes, Google Play Music, or iHeartRadio? We would love to hear your feedback, comments, and questions on our Facebook page at Biblical Elucidation. Please leave us a review on iTunes. This really helps other believers like you find this podcast.